not on the system. All right, now I am. And I understand we're live tonight as well. We're live at 5 o'clock and we're live again, so we're going to the net, so everybody, you know, make your happiest hums behind your masks. It is good and maybe even a little bit unexpected to be together tonight, because just over a week ago, we weren't sure this was going to be possible. And it's so good that a number of you have joined us. A little smaller crowd than normal, but when we add in the people who are streaming online, our service, we've got a real community in the name of Jesus here to celebrate the birth of this special baby. And so I'm so glad that you are here to join us. I just have a couple of little announcements to make here. The first is I want to thank our special guest musicians who are here tonight. Brenda Joyce is playing our piano for us as our accompanist, and very grateful that she is here with us. And then this is this other group that probably needs no introduction, Cardinal Points, who has been with us on many lovely occasions and fundraisers even just this year, and are joining us for Christmas Eve. And I'm so glad that you're all able to be here with us tonight and participate. You're in for some treats before we're done. As you probably know, if you've been to a church service since the pandemic started, we're not yet cleared for singing, but we are encouraging you to sing behind your hymns. We'll probably get you standing up a couple of times. If you feel the need to clap on a song, well, not during their solo, but feel free and just participate in the music that way. When we are finished this service, we're going to ask people if you can please exit out the right side door out of the sanctuary and head out through the upper hall. We've got a nice channel there. The idea is to keep social distancing in place. And so we're asking you, once you get into the channel, it's kind of like, I don't know whether or not any of you have ever driven in Montreal, but there's a couple of places where there's no barrier, no space between the barrier, there's no shoulder, there's nothing, you've got to keep going, please keep going. Otherwise, we might get a little bit of a backup. But it's a gorgeous night if you want to visit outside or even a little bit in the sanctuary when we're done. The problem with visiting in the sanctuary, though, is following the service, at 9 o'clock, we're going to be hosting a communion here. It's not a proper service, but just an opportunity to come take communion together. And if you wish to stay and have communion together, you are very welcome. It's just going to be a 5 or 10 minute liturgy, and we'd love to have you with us if you are able to stay. All right, are we ready? I'm not sure anybody's really ready for the birth of the Christ child into their lives, because when that child comes, things change. But we are hoping in this year of all years, in this Christmas that is different from any that has come before, that that change may give us surprises that were better than anything we could have imagined before we are finished. So let's take that attitude into this Christmas and focus not on what we can't do this Christmas, but on what we can. Let's prepare ourselves as we listen to the ringing of the singing bowl, bringing in Christmas Eve. This Christmas season, because we had all of our Advent services online, I asked people within our congregation to send in pictures of them lighting Advent candles at home, and I was delighted to see that people did. We had pictures almost every week from different people and from the Sunday school, and I asked, on the first Sunday of Advent, I asked whether or not people would light a candle for hope. I hope this lighter will work. And then I asked them on the second Sunday of Advent to light candles at their place for peace. And on the third Sunday of Advent, I asked them to light a candle for joy. The joy candle is always the pink one. If you ever get asked to light candles in church, it's always the pink one. You can't have a somber color like blue on a joy Sunday, can you? It's got to be pink. And then last Sunday, our Sunday school led the way, giving us their COVID Christmas pageant, and we all and our Sunday school and all of us together lit candles for love. Tonight, we light candles for the Christ child,
born in our hearts today. And we sing our song, I invite you to join with me in the prayer that's up on the screen above me. Loving God, you sent your only Son, Jesus, into the world so that all might know of your love. Remind us daily that we are your precious children too. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, the precious child being born into our lives tonight. Amen. We're going to begin with the carol, O Come All Ye Faithful.
O come all ye faithful, to Today's reading is from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 14. The birth of Jesus. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them at the inn. The shepherd and the angels. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told to them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had seen and heard, as it had been told them. And a reading, Psalm 96, Praise to God Who Comes in Judgment. O sing to the Lord a new song, sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name, tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, he is to be revered above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him, strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, "The Lord is king." The world is firmly established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming, to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
So I think I'm probably speaking for all of us here when I say this has been a heck of a year. I don't even need to tell you folks, you all lived through it, right? It's been deeply unexpected, and I'm sort of thinking about some of the differences from where I was a year ago standing up with this particular service where we had pushing 200 people and many people from the community. We were not even allowed to get that many people in here tonight. And as I said, I'm so grateful that you chose to join us and be part of this overall experience. But the contrast is notable. I know that there have been many losses in the last year. We have experienced maybe not so many COVID deaths here in this part of the world, but I know almost everybody I know has lost somebody or knows of somebody that they've lost, or there's been a celebrity who's been important to them, musicians whose songs we've sang and actors' work we've watched. So that's been hard to bear. And then on top of that, there has been, as we sat down and had maybe a slow news cycle because so little was going on in the world, that then created a space into which slowly through the year we realized that Black Lives Matter protests were coming in. And as various people said, that just perhaps the reason why we were getting that news was because COVID had pushed everything else off the pages. And finally the world could pay attention to some very difficult stories that have made us realize that the peace and good order of our society may be more fragile than we thought it was. So it's been a year, really, really has. And here we are on Christmas Eve, the year nearly through, celebrating together the incarnation, which is the wonderful and audacious and, really maybe kind of cheeky idea that we have amongst Christians, that God came to this earth to live with us. That not only this earth, but also human beings are the happening place so much that God wants to live among us, not stay away from us, but be part of it. And as we celebrate that experience of the incarnation, I think maybe I might echo the feeling of more people than one that were really thinking that if there was ever a year we needed God to come down, this would be it. Oh God, come and fix it. I'm going to betray my Star Trek roots here. Scotty, beam me up. That one, right? But as I say that this has been a year, and it certainly has, and for my generation, it may be a defining year before we're done. But I'm also aware that Christmas Eve has come into many other years that were not so easy, too. I grew up in a very large extended family where a number of generations were with each other. We lived with my grandparents until I was 12, and I still remember one day her pulling her box out of the cupboard that she kept in the back of the pantry. This would probably be sometime in the 70s. I think I was in high school at the time, and she opened it up, and she showed me the ration cards that she had from her World War II experience. The idea was that you couldn't buy sugar or butter or I'm not quite sure what the other flours, there were certain kind of vegetables and things like that, because the food was shipped first to the soldiers overseas. And so therefore, everybody else had a certain amount they could buy to make sure that there was enough to support the war effort. And she still had the last tags in that box that she had given. That woman raised 4 kids through the Great Depression and World War II. And she watched her son, who just hit 18 in 1945, get on a Navy ship and ship over to Japan. And she watched him knowing full well that she had also watched her big brother go away to war in the 19-teens, and he never came home. That's something I've never had to face. I hope to God maybe none of us ever have to face that, and none of our children either. But that war generation, they had some pretty dire Christmas Eves. And we know now that the story is happy. My uncle came home and he got married and had a family, and I was putting up tunes on YouTube Facebook this week, and his daughter commented on them. So, there was a happy ending to that story. But I sometimes think about what must she have thought of Christmas Eve. And, if you really want to go further back, if you know me, you'll know I'm a bit of a historian. Not that long ago, we celebrated the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. And 500 years ago, Protestants and Catholics were involved in such bitter conflicts that there was like shooting war, right? And people were going, how is it Christians can be like this? I thought we were all love. So that must have been a rough Christmas Eve too. Or if you really want a rough Christmas Eve, let's go back 2,000 years. Luke tells us a story about a young couple, too young to know what they were doing, which I gotta say, if you're having a baby, that might be all of us. Too young to know what they were in for. And the story that Luke tells is that the Romans who had occupied the country that this young couple lived in declared that there would be a census. And so everyone in the countryside, no matter where they lived now, had to go back to the place that they were born and be counted. And if you know anything about the history of that time, what you will know is the reason why they were being counted is so nobody got away from their taxes. You know, death and taxes, the only two things you can't get away from. It's been going on for a while. And so Mary, who at that point was 9 months pregnant, had to get up with her husband Joseph and walk, or maybe ride on a donkey. And I personally have never ridden on a donkey, but for those who have done it, they say it's not an easy ride. The donkey goes, with every step. So imagine being 9 months pregnant, sitting on the back of one of those, and think how you'd be feeling before too much longer. I don't know, if I were Mary, I might have wanted to walk. I looked it up, and as the crow flies, the distance from Nazareth, where Joseph was working as a carpenter building the beautiful Roman cities out there, and Bethlehem in the south of Israel is about 70 miles as the crow flies, and you probably couldn't go directly. The roads were bandit-infested and very dangerous, and the young couple hardly had a penny to their name to get a hotel when they got to where they were going. They ended up in a cattle stall where the animals lived. Now, technically, it probably wasn't really a barn. Probably what it was all the city houses in that day and age would have a ground floor where the household animals lived, and then a top floor where the family lived above it. So probably what that meant is all the top floors throughout the entire city were occupied, and they ended up stuck with the animals down below. And that's where they had their first child. That was a rough day. The reason why Luke tells this story in this way is because he wants us to understand that the first Christmas came in a world of trouble. There was oppression, there was violence, there was poverty, there was a lack of freedom. And he wants you to know that Jesus came into a situation that was so far from perfect that any trouble that we have, Jesus is also adequate to. It's not about our perfect Christmas. It's not about, the various things that we worry about. I mean, I know that the last couple days, my biggest worry has been making sure I've got gifts for everybody under the tree. Nothing compared to having to walk 70 miles while 9 months pregnant. Nothing compared to having a foreign army occupy my country. And our society teaches us that our goal is that perfect, glittering Christmas with the beautifully wrapped presents and the perfect table. And for many of you, this might be the most unreal fantasy at all. Nobody fighting the whole evening. And yet, Luke tells us that no, Jesus came to a world that wasn't so perfect. He came to be with us in our imperfections. So maybe we don't need to try so hard for that perfect Christmas experience, which the magazines tells us is the whole deal, but sometimes falls a little flat. And I know for me, the best part of Christmas is always being with the ones I love. And so just maybe, that's what Jesus' Christmas was about too. The little miracle of Jesus' child being born was a small miracle. I think we like to think of God as very grand and full of, power and honor and everyone bowing and all that kind of stuff. Our Christmas carols talk about Jesus being king. We go there very quickly. But when you read the story in the Bible, what it talks about is Jesus being very small. A newborn baby, completely helpless, unable to do almost anything for himself. But the one thing that the Jesus child has is the power that even a newborn baby has. The power that the grown Jesus went and made and put out there to change the world. And that power is the power of love. From such small beginnings grow great things. And that's how it is with our faith too. So what I'm going to encourage you to do in this year of years, that has been like no other, is when you go out from this place, don't focus on the Christmas that you don't have. Focus on the Christmas that you do have. Go look for the signs of love growing in small places. Go look for the signs that the trouble that we've seen this year has woken up the powerful and change is going to come. Because I think that that kind of attitude and that way of seeing is what Jesus really wants us from us more than anything. Get that little spark of love and then spread it around. I think it's a year we could all use a little more love in our lives. So stay safe. Take care of each other. Remember that your nose is attached to your lungs when you put your mask on. Follow the public health dictates and look for the signs of love that are growing even in our year this year, even in our place here. And that's how the Christ child leads us. And that's how we'll get through to the other side. Amen. All right, fam. Does that mean she's got my copy too? That would be good news. I have my whole family home. Some of you have not met my daughter, Allison, who just read scripture for us. We wish to assure you we did full 14 days of quarantine when she got here. But we're here now and we're going to sing. And I discovered the first service that nobody in my family knew that this was a Mariah Carey standard, right? But it is. We're going to sing Jesus, What a Wonderful Child. All right, ready?
So lonely, meek and mild, new life.
So they tell me they're going to leave the offering back there, but I do want to give a hearty thanks to all those who in many ways have supported the work of St. Luke's over the last year in particular. It's been a heck of a year, but we are really delighted that we're managing through the various things we've done and programs we've managed to make happen, that we're going to come out of it, we think, mostly okay. And that's been how, thanks to you, people have been so good and generous to us. And in the last year, not only have we managed to keep our programs going and our staff working and all that sort of thing, we've also managed to put solar panels on our roof and ran a really successful solar campaign to start working to pay for those so that we can put green energy out there into the grid and stop the reliance of Nova Scotia on coal and other sorts of things like that, which we think is a big part of our vision. So it is thanks to all of you who have been so very generous to us, both in financial terms, but also in talents and gifts. And we see some of this on display here today. So I am so happy that we have, in this gift season of gift giving, that we have had so many of you give so richly to us. So thank you. And we're gonna keep going with our witness in the years to come. So before we move on, let's just have a moment to share a prayer for the gifts. O God, you bring to birth abundant life. We thank you for the birth we celebrate today. In response to your great labor of love, we offer our gifts. As we open ourselves to you, may your love be born in us and into our world this Christmas day. Amen. Now we're going to hear some music from our featured performers.
Song is holy.
Just take a few moments for prayer before we go. Thank you, scandalous God, for giving yourself to the world, not in the powerful and extraordinary, but in weakness and the familiar, in a baby, in bread and wine. Thank you for offering at Journey's End a new beginning, for setting in the poverty of the stable the richest jewel of your love, for revealing in a particular place your light for all nations. Thank you for bringing us to Bethlehem, which means house of bread, where the empty are filled and the filled are emptied, where the poor find riches and the rich recognize their poverty, where all who kneel and hold out their hand are unstintingly fed. And we pray now as the grown Jesus taught us, adding the words at the beginning, our mother and father, and we begin there. Our mother and father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So as we go from worship this night, may the joy of the angels sing in our voices. May the hope of the shepherds enliven our minds. May the strong faith of Mary strengthen our hearts. May the love of the baby shine in our spirits. God's blessing be upon you all, this holy night and forever. Amen. We're going to go out with Silent Night. We'll just take a moment to light the candles with the singers, and then we will sing three verses, and you guys have a really important part because we want to hum together a fourth verse, and you've been practicing humming this whole time. So I know you're ready for this. And then maybe the house lights can go down just as we do this final verse.
to yours. Merry Christmas.